Okay. We are trying to do a reading passage today. This reading passage is Dawn of the Robots. This is taken from the official IELTS book. This is, I think, the second test in the official IELTS book, and we are going to do this. So whenever we get a passage, the first thing you have to look at is what are the kind of questions that you have on the passage. And here we find that 14 to 19 are list of headings. You know, you have to match the headings. So that is the task. There are six questions for matching the headings. And then we look at what are the other things on this. We look at that 20 to 23 are matching information, basically. We have to find out which of these questions, which of these statements have been said by either Bill Gates or Nello Christianini or Ron Quisling. So it's basically about matching information. That's the kind of that's the type of question that is. And 24 to 26, we find that it is fill in the blanks with no more than three words. So what we know here is that only the fill in the blanks will go in a chronological order in the passage. It will go in a systematic order. 25 will come after 24 and 26 will come after 25, right? So we know that this is the only thing which will go in order, whereas this will not go in a systematic order, and obviously the matching the headings are never in a systematic order because that will make it too easy for you. So what do we do next? We look at the questions and see if there's something easy to spot. Right, look at questions 22 to 23. Is there anything that is easy to spot? An important concern for scientists is to ensure robots seem frightening. Robots will take considerable time for modern robots to match films and books. None of these four questions have anything like a major word, a number, a name, or a place, or anything of the sort. But here we have got these three names: Bill Gates, Nello Christianini, and Ron Quisling. These three names have to come in the passage somewhere. So the first thing we quickly do is to identify where in the passage these three names come. So we keep this in mind: Bill Gates, Nello Christianini, and Ron Quisling. And we just scan the entire passage to see where Bill Gates is coming. I'm using the cursor here for the moment, but in real life I would be using my finger to just run through this in this manner to see where I can find Bill Gates, Nello Christianini, and Ron Quisling. I find Bill Gates here, right? So Bill Gates is here. So what I do is I just highlight this here. I highlight this here. In the real test, I would be underlining this word, right? So Gates comes in paragraph C. That's what I know, right? So now I look for the other two people. Gates also comes in paragraph D. You should not forget that. You should not just stick to one place, right? Gates also comes in paragraph D. We need two other names. Whenever somebody's name is mentioned and their quote is mentioned, often it will be in inverted quotes, like here. Now we have become far more pragmatic in the real world, says Nello Christianini. So here I have another word that I want to highlight. Right, I found Nello Christianini, and now I need to find one more Ron Quisling. And I find it in the same paragraph. Right, Ron Quisling. I've not read what they have said. I've just marked where I find these three things. So I know that where to find the answers 22 to 23. Right, 20, 21, 22, 23 will be available for me only in paragraph C, D, E. Okay, I can see Quisling here also. Right, so C, D, E, and F. So C, D, E, and F, I'm finding the answers for 20 to 23. So which means in paragraph A and B, I will not be finding the answers to this question. Right? So next, I look at these three things. 24, 25, 26, DARPA cars, Electrolex, trilobite, and robot kitchen humanoids. Right? I try to find where will I find the words DARPA, Electrolex, trilobite, and robot kitchen in the paragraphs. So let me just go back there and see where I can find DARPA, Electrolux trilobite. Here I find DARPA, right? Here I find DARPA. So here I highlight this DARPA, and here again I find DARPA. So again I highlight DARPA, right? So I know that the answer to question number 24 is in either paragraph A or paragraph B. So I just tentatively write my question numbers here. I'll actually be scribbling this in the margins here in the end. Now here I'm not able to do that, but if it's a pen and paper test, I would be scribbling my answers here in the right margin, saying this is 24, right? This is 24. Now I look for 25. 25, I need to find Electrolux trilobite. Do we have it here? I find it here, right? This is Electrolux trilobite, right? I highlight this and write my answer 25 here. So in this paragraph, I'll be finding answer for 25, right? I need to see for the last one, robot kitchen, and here I find robot kitchen humanoid was mentioned there. Here I find robot kitchen. So my answer for 26 is here, right? I've marked my answers for 24, 25, 26. I've marked my answers for these three names. Now I start reading the paragraphs. At first sight, it looked like a typical suburban road accident. A Land Rover approached a Chevy Tahoe estate car that had stopped at a curb. The Land Rover pulled out and tried to pass the Tahoe just as it started off again. There was a crack of fenders and the sound of paintwork being scrapped or scraped, the kind of minor mishap that occurs on roads thousands of times every day. Normally, drivers get out, gesticulate, exchange insurance details, and then drive off. But not on this occasion. No one got out of the car for the simple reason that they had no humans inside. The Tahoe and Land Rover were being controlled by computers competing in the November's DARPA, the US Defense Advanced Research Project Urban Challenge. I finished reading paragraph 1. I know that I'll be finding probably the answer for 24 in this, but before that, I want to find an answer for this, right? So moment I read paragraph A, I just go and take a look at the headings. Which heading will match this? Right? Which of the headings will match this? And one way to do the matching the heading is to go by elimination, right? Now look at this, tackling the issue using a different approach. In this paragraph, we talked nothing about tackling a thing using a different approach, or that a previous approach was tried out and a different approach has been tried now. So this is not an answer for this, right? A significant improvement on last time, which again would mean that a previous time should have been mentioned, that something happened previously and now a different approach has been done. Again, I find that in this paragraph, I did not find anything concerning that, right? How robots can save human lives. Accidents, human lives, is it possible something was there here? Did it talk about saving human lives? It just said about minor mishaps. No, it did not talk of, yes, these cars were controlled by computers, but these cars did not, this paragraph did not say anything about saving human lives, right? So I eliminate saving human lives. Examples of robots at work. Examples of robots at work, right? Examples of robots at work. So do I have examples of robots? Here only one car has been mentioned, right? There are no examples of robots at work here. We did not talk of any multiple things. Examples, that's a cue for me. It's a plural, right? So there are no examples of robots at work here. So I eliminate that. Not what it seemed to be. This first line says, at first sight, it looked like a typical road accident, right? So when at first glance, it looked like a road accident, and then it goes on to say that it was not a typical road accident because there were no humans inside the car, right? No humans inside them. No one got out of the car for the simple reason that no humans were inside them. So it looks like this could be the answer, not what it seemed to be. But I will not mark the answer yet. I will be looking at these other lists also. I will be looking at the other possible headings and want to eliminate them. Right? Why timescales are impossible to predict? No, there was nothing about timescales in this. The reason why robots rarely move? No, this was all about cars, so it is not reasons why robots rarely move. Following the pattern of an earlier development? No, there is nothing mentioned about an earlier development or a pattern. And the last one, the ethical issues of robotics. Nothing about the ethical issues of robotics came in this. So for me, the answer for this would be not what it seemed to be. So for question number 14, my answer is 5. Right? So I go back here. Then I look at this. I have marked here 24. So what's 24 question? DARPA race cars dash provided maps and plans for route. Did I find anything which says what provided maps and plans for routes? Nothing of that sort is mentioned here, right? We did not come across any information which said how maps and plans or routes. No such word has come here. So I move on to paragraph B. So I start reading paragraph B. The idea that machines could perform at such standards is startling. Driving is a complex task that takes humans a long time to perfect. Yet here, each car had its onboard computer loaded with digital maps and route plans and was instructed to negotiate busy routes, differentiate between pedestrians and stationary objects, determine whether other vehicles were parked or moving off, and handle various parking maneuvers, which robots turned out to be unexpectedly adept at. Even more striking was the fact that collision between the robot Land Rover built by the researchers at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology and the Tahoe fitted out with the Cornell University Artificial Intelligence AI experts was the only scrape in the entire competition. Yet, only 3 years earlier at DARPA's previous driverless car race, every robot competitor directed to navigate across a stretch of open desert either crashed or seized up before getting to the finish line. So again, let's look at 24. I should find answer for 24. But before going to 24, I'll go for 15, right? Paragraph B. So what was this paragraph all about? That it was giving us the details about how the driverless cars were handling the different maneuvers of parking, and they turned out to be unexpectedly adept at it, striking fact that the collision was the only thing. But 3 years earlier, every car had either stopped before the finishing line or crashed out. Right? So that's the information we have here. So let's look at all these things. Tackling the issue using a different approach? No. We did not use a different approach to tackle here. We have been continuing to talk about the same DARPA car race, what we talked about in paragraph A. And we are continuing that here. There's nothing about using a different approach. A significant improvement on last time. The idea that machines could perform is startling, driving complex maneuvers. Here in this last sentence, it says, yet only 3 years earlier, at DARPA's previous driverless car race, every robot competitor directed to navigate across a stretch of open desert either crashed or seized up. But this time in the car race, the only thing was a minor scrap. Right, it was a minor accident that happened between the two cars. Right, so this seems to be the one that fits it, a significant improvement on last time. But let's also look at the other options. How robots can save human lives? No, nothing about human lives is mentioned in this. Examples of robots at work, we still continue to talk about the driverless cars. We did not give any other examples of robots at work. Not what it seemed to be. No, it is not about that. Time scales are impossible to predict. There was nothing about the time scales in this. Time scales would mean something will happen 5 years down the line, something will happen 10 years down the line. That would be the prediction of time scales. Nothing of that sort happened. The reasons why robots rarely move, nothing about, this is again about the cars, so nothing about why robots cannot move. Following the pattern of earlier development, could that be that we improved last time? But nothing of that sort is mentioned here, right? In a sense of it's about a pattern of an earlier development, that something else had developed in one way and this is also developing in the same way. That's a pattern, right? Something you did some time back and now you're doing it again. That would be a pattern of development. We did not find anything about that. The ethical issues of robotics, nothing about ethics has come in this. Ethics would be about whether it's a correct thing to do or a wrong thing to do. No, it's about right and wrong. Ethics and morality are related. So there's nothing about ethics in this. So for us, the answer for B would be a significant improvement on last time, right? So answer to question number 15 would be 2. So we put 2 here, then we go back. What do we have? We now need to find answer for 24 in this. So we go back to check question number 24 and it says Dash provides maps and plans for route. Something provides maps and plans for route. So what did we find here? It takes human beings a long time to propagate. Each car had its onboard computer. Loaded it digital maps and route plans. Right? So digital maps and route plans and was instructed to negotiate busy roads. So here we find our clue here, digital maps and route plans. And this In each car, there was an onboard computer which had the digital maps and route plans. That's what this sentence tells us. What does this fill in the blanks ask us? In the DARPA race cars, Dash provided maps and plans for route. So our answer for that would be onboard, right? Onboard computer. This is our answer for that, right? This is our answer for that. Onboard computer. So onboard is one word. Any hyphenated word is regarded as one word. And then computer, two words. So what do we have? How many words should we do it? No more than 3 words. So onboard computer would be the answer for our thing. So we go back. 24, right? So we answer 24 as onboard computer. That's our answer for 24, right? So we go back to paragraph C. It is remarkable, it's a remarkable transition that had clear implications for the car of the future. More importantly, it demonstrates how robotic sciences and artificial intelligence have progressed in the past few years, a point stressed by Bill Gates, the Microsoft boss who is a convert to these causes. The robotics industry is developing in much the same way the computer business did 30 years ago, he argues. As he points out, electronic companies make toys that mimic pets and children with increasing sophistication. Some spelling mistake. It can envision a future in which robotic devices will become nearly ubiquitous part of our day-to-day life, says Gates. We may be on the verge of a new era when a PC will get off the desktop and allow its users to see, hear, touch and manipulate objects in places where we are not physically present. So the first thing we do is look for the heading match. Here Gates talked of what? That it's a remarkable transition that has clear implications for the car of the future. Demonstrates our progress in the past few years, he says. The robotic industry is developing in much the same way that the computer business did 30 years ago, he argues. And then robotic device will become ubiquitous. They will be there everywhere. That's what this word means. And we are on the verge of a new era, right? So that's the summary of the paragraph. Tackling the issue with a different approach? No. Nothing of that sort has been mentioned about that we are tackling it with a different approach. Significant improvement on last time? No. How robots save human lives, there's nothing in the paragraph about human lives or how it can be saved. Examples of robots at work, there are no examples given here. That Gates only mentions that the robotic industry is developing the same way as the computer business did 30 years ago. So there are no examples of robots robots at work, not what it seemed to be. No, it doesn't suit that. Why timescales are impossible to predict? Does Gates anything about timescales? No, he doesn't talk about anything here about timescales. You know, so timescales is not part of this answer. The reason why robots, I use both. So the reasons why robots rarely move, nothing of that sort has come in this. Following the pattern of an earlier development, what did he say here? The robotics industry is developing in much the same way that the computer did 30 years ago, right? Much the same way as the computer did 30 years ago. So this is like he's saying, what Gates is saying is that 30 years back, the way the computer industry developed, the robotic industry is following in the same way, which means the same pattern is being followed, right? So for us, this seems to be the answer, following the pattern of an earlier development, because nothing about the ethical issues have been mentioned here. So when we eliminate everything, for us the only possibility is following the pattern of an earlier development, right? That seems to be the only one. So what is the answer for that? C is 8. 16 is 8. We go back. Do we have to find the answers for anything else in C? Bill Gates, right? We got Bill Gates mentioned here. So we check about this part, right? An important concern for scientists is to ensure robots did not seem frightening. Bill Gates did not talk about that. What Bill Gates has said, one, it's given in the inverted quotes here. Always look at when you get to think of what somebody said, often either it is given in the quotes, like this inverted quotes here, or he said, she said, he thinks, he believes, you know, those kind of words are used. Yeah, what Gates has said is the robotic industry is developing in much the same way as the computer business did 30 years ago. He points out electronic companies make toys that mimic pets and children with increasing sophistication. Right? We may be on the verge of a new era. Desktop PCs to hear, touch, manipulate objects not physically present. So, an important concern for scientists is to ensure that robots do not seem frightening. No, Gates did not say that. We have stopped trying to enable robots to perceive objects as humans do. He did not say anything about that. It will take a considerable time for modern robots to match the ones we have created in films and books. Gates did not talk anything about films and books or how much time it's going to take. We need to enable robots to move freely before we think about trying to communicate with them. Gates did not say anything about that we have to first make robots flexible or mobile before we teach them how to communicate. He did say nothing about that. So paragraph C does not have an answer for any of these four, right? So now we move on to paragraph D. What is the potential for robots and computers in the near future? The fact is, we still have a way to go before real robots catch up with their science fiction counterparts, Gates says. So what are the stumbling blocks? One key difficulty is getting robots to know their place. This has nothing to do with class or etiquette, but concerns the simple issue of positioning. Humans orient themselves with either objects in a room very easily, with other objects in a room very easily. Robots find the task almost impossible. Even something as simple as telling the difference between an open door and a window can be tricky for robots, says Gates. This has until recently reduced robots to a fairly static and cumbersome roles, right? So what is our first thing? We need to look at matching the heading. What has the potential of robots got in the future? Long way to go before that. Etiquette concerns. Robots find it the task almost impossible. Even something as telling a difference between open door and window can be tricky for robots, he says. This has until recently reduced robots to a fairly static and cumbersome roles. So let's look at the options. Tackling the issue with a different approach? No. Gates did not talk of anything about tackling the issue with a different approach. A significant improvement over last time? No, there's nothing talked about that. Nothing about saving human lives. He has not given any examples of robots. He has just talked about how robots the development of robots is mentioned only, but and he said that they can't distinguish between a door, window, something of that sort. So no, not examples, not what it seemed to be. No, it doesn't suit that. Why time scales are impossible to predict? Gates did not mention about anything about the time scales. The reasons why robots rarely move. Did we find something for that? What is the potential for robots and computers in the future? Long way to go before they catch up with the science fiction counterparts. Robots positioning is a problem for robots. They can't orient themselves. They cannot see the difference between doors and windows. Until recently, this is the reason why robots are fairly static and cumbersome. Static means staying in the same place, right? Dynamic means moving from one place to another place. Static means staying in the same place. So does that suit that? The reasons why robots rarely move. Looks like that is the one that suits it. Let's look at the other things to eliminate it. Following the pattern of an earlier development, no. This paragraph was not about earlier development, and no ethical issues were discussed. So when I look at the options and I eliminate the options which don't suit this, the only thing that is left for me is the reasons why robots rarely move, right? And that's what comes here. Sometimes the last two sentences, the first two sentences do give you a cue sometimes, but not always. But here we find that, right? We find that the robots had been fairly reduced to static roles. So that's what that paragraph was about. So I go back to check my thing. So 17 would be 7. So now I go back to check. Paragraph D, I need to find about gates, right? So here, we again look at this paragraph. What is the potential for robots to read in the competition? He says the long way to go to catch up before the science fiction counterparts. Etiquettes, human oriented themselves easily, robot find it difficult. They find it difficult to tell between door and window, right? So now we go and take a look at this. An important concern for scientists is to ensure robots do not seem frightening. Gates did not talk about any concern for scientists. No scientist was mentioned in this paragraph. We have stopped trying to enable robots to perceive objects as humans do. No, Gates did not talk about anything of that sort. It will take a considerable time for modern robots to match the ones we have created in films and books. Did he say something of that sort? What is the potential for robots and computers in the near future? The fact is, we still have a long way to go before robots catch up with their science fiction counterpart, Gates says. Right, so this is the cue for science fiction is books and movies, right? Science fiction, fiction is a book or it can also be a movie, right? So and here he says that the science fiction is far ahead than reality always, right? Many things happen in the science fiction movies where the reality has to catch up with it, right? So here we have got an answer for this. It will take a considerable time for the modern robots to catch up for the ones we have created in films and books. So 22. The answer is A. Right? 22, the answer is A. We did not worry, we don't have to worry about Nello Christiani and Ron Quisling because we are not to come to that. So now we move on to paragraph E. For a long time, researchers tried to get around the problem by attempting to create the visual processing that goes on in the human cortex. However, that challenge has proved to be singularly exacting and complex. So scientists have turned to simpler alternatives. We have become far more pragmatic in our work, says Nello Christianini, professor of artificial intelligence at the University of Bristol in England, and associate editor of the Journal of Artificial Intelligence Research. We are no longer trying to recreate human functions. Instead, we are looking for simpler solutions with the basic electronic sensors, for example. This approach is exemplified by vacuuming robots such as Electrolux Trilobite. The Trilobite scuttles around homes emitting ultrasound signals to create maps of rooms which are remembered for future cleaning. Technology like this is now changing the face of robotics, says philosopher Ron Quisling, director of the Center for Research in Cognitive Science at the University of Sussex in England. Right? Now we look at this paragraph. This talked about earlier they were trying to recreate a visual processing system. However, the challenge proved to be exacting, so scientists have turned to simpler alternatives. We become more pragmatic and we are no longer trying to create human functions. Instead, we are trying to do simpler solutions with electronic sensors. Right? So now we look at the options. What do we have? Tackling the issue using a different approach. That seems to be something, right? Here, earlier they were trying to do something. For a long time, researchers tried to get around the problem by creating to recreate the visual processing that goes on in the human cortex. Now they are not doing it, right? Because it was very exacting. Exacting means difficult, and it was complex. So scientists have turned to simpler alternatives. They become far more pragmatic. We no longer trying to recreate human functions. Instead, we are trying to look for simpler solutions using basic electronic sensors, right? So that seems to be the answer. Tackling the issue with it using a different approach. We'll also look at others before we kind of finalize that. A significant improvement over last time? No, it's not an improvement over last time, or is it? That's another way, like, right? Earlier we were doing something, but now we are improving it over last time. So this is also a possibility. One is also a possibility, and two is also a possibility for us, right? And then three, robots can save human lives? No. Examples of robots at work? No. Only one thing came in, that electrolux trilobite was the only thing mentioned. Now, not at what seems to be, no, that's not what it is. Timescales are impossible to predict, nothing about timescales came in. The reason why robots rarely move, no. Here we actually were talking about a vacuum cleaning robot which moves around the room. Following the pattern of an earlier development, nothing of that sort was mentioned and no ethical issues were mentioned. So for us, the confusion could be that could it be one or could it be two? Right, so what we will do is for paragraph E, right, it could be one or it could be two. So we just go back to, so this could be one or two, right? So either this is one or this is two, right? So this two possibilities are there for us. One or two, right? We'll just keep it like that. We will not finalize it right now. We will not finalize that right now, right? So we go back to the paragraph. And we found Nello Christianini saying something here, right? What did he say? We have become far more pragmatic in our work, says Christiani. And then we are no longer trying to recreate human functions. Instead, we are looking for simpler solutions with basic electronic sensors, for example. That's what he said, right? So what are the statements given here? An important concern for scientists is to ensure robots do not seem frightening. No, nothing of the thing about frightening came in. We have stopped trying to enable robots to perceive human objects as humans do. Yes, that's what he said, right? We're no longer trying to create human functions. Instead, we are looking for simpler solutions. So Nello Christianini said that. So the answer for 21 would be B, right? 21 is B. And then 22, it will take a considerable time for modern robots. No, we already found an answer for this. We need to enable robots to move freely before we think about trying to communicate with them. Did he say anything of the sort? Oh, we still have Don quickly saying something here, right? What did he say? Technology like this is now changing the face of the robotics, says philosopher Ron Priestley. That's all he said. Ron Priestley only has said that technology like this changes the face. He did not say anything about robots should be less frightening, and he did not say anything about that robots should be freely moving. But we also found that we have marked Electrolux trilobite here as 25, right? So we look at 25, question number 25. Electrolux trilobite builds an image of a room by sending out something, right? This Electrolux trilobite is the robot, the vacuum cleaning robot we read about. it builds an image of a room by sending out something. How does it, what does it send out? What do we have? Electrolux stylobat comes in here, right? This approach has been exemplified by vacuum cleaning robots like Electrolux stylobat. The stylobat scuttles around homes, emitting ultrasound signals to create maps of rooms, right? So it emits ultrasound signals to create maps of rooms. So ultrasound signals is two words. Does it fit here? It builds an image of a room by sending out ultrasound signals. Excellent. So does ultrasound, is it a one word? It's one word and then signals. So I need to look at that. This is a plural, right? Ultrasound signals. Signals is a plural. So I should write ultrasound signals, not signal, right? So the answer for 25 is ultrasound signals. So go back. Now I'm just left with one paragraph to read, right? The last paragraph is left. Let's read the last paragraph. Last year, a new Hong Kong restaurant, Robot Kitchen, opened with a couple of sensor-laden humanoid machines directing customers to their seats. Each possesses a touch screen on which orders can be keyed in. The robot then returns with the correct dishes. In Japan, University of Tokyo researchers recently unveiled a kitchen android that could wash dishes, pour tea, and make a few limited meals. The ultimate aim is to provide robot home helpers for the sick and the elderly, a key concern in a city like Japan, where 22% of the population is 65 or older. Over US $1 billion a year is being spent on research into robots that will be able to care for the elderly. Robots first learn basic competence, how to move around a house without bumping into things. Then we can think about teaching them how to interact with humans, Chrisley said. Machines such as these take researchers into the field of socialized robotics, how to make robots act in a way that does not scare or offend individuals. We need to study how robots should approach people, how they should appear. That's going to be the key area of future research, says Chrisley. Right? So here we were talking about robot kitchen humanoids, right? And then in Japan, they talked about an android which helps to pour tea and stuff like that. So we got two examples of robots here. So somewhere we saw that there was an example of robots. Examples of robots at work. But just let's run through the list before that. Tackling the issue of using a different approach, no. Significant improvement on the last time, doesn't suit it. Robots saving human lives. Did it talk about some human lives, old age people? The aim of robots is to help sick and elderly, but nothing about saving human lives is there. Nothing about saving human lives is there, right? So examples of robots at work, yes, we immediately got the thing that there were two robots being talked about. Not what it seemed to be, doesn't apply. Time scales are impossible to predict. The philosopher, what was his name? Ron Kusli, he did not say anything about that it's impossible to predict time scales. Reasons why robots rarely move, nothing about that mentioned. Following a pattern of earlier development, doesn't suit it. No ethical issues were mentioned, were they? Was there anything about ethics in this? Teaching humans how to interact with humans, do not scare or offend individuals, but that's not ethics, right? So the only thing that we find from the list that suits this particular one is examples of robots at work, robots at work. So 4 is the answer for 19. Right? So we have answered all, and here we find that this can be 1 or 2, and this can only be 2. Right? 15 is only 2, whereas 18 can be 1 and 2. So obviously it leaves us with the answer that this is not 2, it's got to be only 1 by just pure process of elimination, right? So we go back. What are the questions we are left with answering? 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20 we have to answer, and 23 we need an answer. 20 and 23 we need an answer. So we go back to see this 20 and 23. An important concern for scientists is to ensure robots do not seem frightening. So what are the quotes in this, or either the quotes or here we have the first quotes. Robots first learn to use basic competence, how to move around a house without bumping into things. Then we can think about teaching them how to interact with humans, right? Nothing about frightening has come there. These two we've already answered. We need to enable robots to move freely before we think about trying to communicate with them, right? Robots first learn basic competence, how to move around the house without bumping into things. Then we can teach them about interacting with humans, right? So that's what Chris Lee has said. So the answer for 23 is B. That leaves us with just finding the answer for 20, right? An important concern for scientists is to ensure that robots do not seem frightening. So far, we have not come across anything of the sort. Robots first learn basic competence, how to move around the house without bumping into things. Then we can teach them how to interact with humans. Machines such as this take researchers into the field of socialized robotics. How to make robots in a way that does not scare or offend individuals. Right? What is this sentence? An important concern for scientists is to ensure robots do not seem frightening. Right? Frightening is scare. Right? Scaring is being frightened, afraid, being afraid. Right. So, Chris Lee has said that the concern is to how to make robots act in a way that do not scare or offend individuals. We need to study robots should approach people, how they should appear. This is going to be the key area of future research. So, our answer for 20 is also B. Answer for 20 is also B. So have we answered everything? 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25. So that brings us to the close. We have answered all the questions by going through the entire passage only once. We read each paragraph. We first mark. What's the method we adopted? We first looked at the passage and then looked at the questions, right? And when we look at the questions, we first make a note of which are the questions that the answers will come in a systematic order in the passage. And in this paragraph, in this passage, the only thing that would come in the systematic order would be the fill in the blanks. Right? All the others, the matching the information, matching the headings, will not come in order. So we have marked 24, 25, and 26, we marked the paragraphs where we found the answer. In real test, in more than marking the paragraph, I would just mark the line itself. I will underline and then mark in the margin 24, 25, 26. I'll write the question number there so that I can know, I can go back there to find the answer for that. And then we started reading, we just marked Bill Gates, Ron Chrisley, and Nello Christianini. Those three names, we just marked them in the paragraphs so that we know where those names appear. Those are the places where we would find the answers. We read paragraph 1, we first match the headings. Matching the headings, the best way to match the headings is to first eliminate all what doesn't suit. First go by the process of elimination. This A doesn't suit, B doesn't suit, C doesn't suit. So what suits? If more than one thing suits it, mark both and keep it. We'll again do a process of elimination further when we read the further paragraphs. Then we'll read paragraph B, again match the headings. And then look into the paragraph B and say, are there any fill-in-the-blanks questions on this paragraph? Are there any matching information paragraphs on this, questions on this paragraph? So we just read a paragraph only once. We don't go back to it. So this way what happens is we save a lot of time and we are not burdened by trying to keep too much of information in our head. And we are not just hunting for keywords, you know, all the time. The process of, you know, marking keywords in the question and then hunting them throughout the, for every question, it takes too much of time, and if you don't even understand the question, it's very difficult to answer the questions, right? So what I would suggest is reading, understanding the question is the best way to find answers for the reading passages. And read a paragraph, understand the paragraph, what's the content of the paragraph. Then you can go back and look at the questions and it becomes very easy to find the answer there. I hope that helped. So that actually took us about 40 minutes to do the entire passage, right? 40 minutes to do the 13 or 14 questions that were there on the passage. That's because we read out the passage loudly, we discussed, methods were explained. So that's why it takes such a long time. But if you actually do it, you know, you just do a silent reading, you do a quick scanning of the passages and then you mark the thing and you go very fast. It takes you roughly about 15 to 16 minutes to do a passage. Right, so if three passages should take you about 48 minutes in this method, right, you are reading a paragraph only once and marking all the answers. So it saves a lot of time for you. You get nearly about 10 minutes at the end to even check your answers. So if you like this method, if you find this method efficient, be my guest.